blue little rose. You are crying. I am trying to let you know that I love you so, sweet little rose. Let your petals sway on your lonely days in the wind of my heart. I can set you free if you'll just run to me. All the thorns will go away if you'll stay with me. Blue little rose, blue little rose. All the thorns will go away if you stay with me. Let's start with an old tape. Or not. Good evening. It is time. Or I'm early. I don't know. I don't know anymore. I just turn these things on and see what happens. So, let's get this thing going here. Oh, that's interesting. I'm getting cool blue lights. Well, how are you? How are all of you? Hi. Let's get the lights on a little bit here. Ooh, there we go. Now you can see me. Still like that blue light in the corner there. I'm going to keep it. So, I'm going to try to fix this a little. So, I'm hoping you can hear me and everything's good. By next week, I think I'm going to go back to the other mic now that there's no ashes in the air, and I think we can safely put the more expensive mic back up. Either that or I'm going to try something completely different. Although I like this mic, I just have to get up real close in order for you to hear me. And I guess it would be fine if I held it in my hand, but not going to happen tonight. Well, that's another option, I guess. How are you guys? How is everyone? I see I've got YouTube. I've got Facebook going. I see that we've got Twitch happening. Gosh. Hi, everyone. Welcome to, I guess we're going to call it a best of, because what's going to happen here is that I'm going to read from these little lists that I took. And on a separate tab, I have notes from everybody that submitted their songs that they wanted to hear. Now, that doesn't mean I didn't cheat. I did cheat. So I'm going to cheat, and we need to put the disclaimer here, and I'm going to do it in black and white so that you know I'm not lying. So it's in black and white. So the disclaimer is that just because you asked for a song, that doesn't mean that the version you're going to hear is that version. It may be something else, or it may be, you know, however it plays out, my friends. But I think that's better. So some people said, you know. Eric says, I'm kind of late, guys. I was watching the X-Files movie. Is that a new movie, Eric, or an old one? Because that sounds like fun. So maybe we should do that one of these nights. Just put on a movie and we all watch it together. And I just sit back and do nothing and just watch a movie with you guys. I would do that. I would definitely do that. So it's been a weird week. Finally, some aspects of home life are coming together. What I mean by that is that there are no more surgeries for me. I'm done. Everything's good. I can now fully recuperate and not have to worry about any more visits to the dentist for another year. So I've got a year to do whatever I got to do. So that said, that means that I can now actually start going to rehearsals. Without having to give away details here, I don't have to do the intermediary stages that I was doing, which was a bit of a pain to get my speaking voice and singing voice in order. So now I can actually practice with what will be forever. So I'm getting used to it. It's not that easy, but I am getting used to it. It's going to be fantastic. So on that level, I'm happy. Everything's good and back to some sort of normal for me in that sense. Been recording a lot. I should say I've been drawing a lot. And can you guys hear me okay? Just show of hands if you can hear me okay. Because if not, I'll take this guy down. I guess it'll help if I point it at my direction. Oh, it's very directional. The one cool thing that I got to tell you about that has to do with this mic is that the other night I actually tried it out with my mobile recording setup, and it picked up nothing but my voice, considering that I was outside, and it picked up no outside noises. So I kind of like it. So I'm going to try some vocals with this when I'm getting to that stage. But anyway, I digress. So I think we should play a song and start things off, because it's past 8 and those that are tuning in are probably going like, hey, where's the music at? So let me explain. I'm going to show this. We are at Quarren Stream 29. The one right before Halloween, which I'm already planning. So I'm hoping that you will not miss next week's, because it's going to be out of this world crazy. I may even, you know I'm going to do something, right? So I'm going to probably dress up just for fun. And it happens to fall on the day before Halloween, so it should be all good. So let's play a song from one of the requests, because that's the whole point of this episode, if you want to call it that, is that I was going to take requests. So I'm looking at one of the, you know, there's one that was really cool here that I'm going to play. So I'm going to start, I think I'm going to start with that song and then I'll come back. So one of the first people that ever wrote to me when we got signed, which, you know, you have to understand, we got signed and then, my phone's ringing. Sorry, man. Can't get that phone right now. it's so funny. My phone rings. I think I better turn off the ringer. I will check and see who that was when I come back. But anyway, I don't know if I even did it right. So when we got signed, we started to get fan mail. And it's one of those funny things. We didn't realize we would get fan mail sent to Epic Records or, you know, Sony Music at that time or whatever. And they would call us and say, hey, you've got some fan mail. So the funny thing was, the very first time they called and said this to us, I was so excited that I drove all the way there, even though there was basically one letter. But I'm really happy that I did that, because not only did this person and I become pen pals, but she became a good friend of mine, and we've been friends ever since. And she's largely responsible for us returning to Seattle last year. So this request that begins the whole thing is going to be for Becky, my friend Becky. And she wrote, and she sent this in through Twitter. Sorry, Becky, I hope you're not getting embarrassed by this, but says, Soldier and Child, you sent me Worth right after Germany and told me it would never see the light of day due to issues with Epic. I cried for days thinking no one would ever hear this album. I always remember that when I hear Soldier and Child, World Without Love, etc. So it's not so much that her request touched me. It was that the fact that our friendship goes back that far, that is amazing to me. So this one's going to be for Becky, and it's Soldier and Child, and it's going to be the demo version. So for visuals, we'll use the tape machine, all right? So I'm going to play it, and then, you know, all that good stuff. I don't even know where I put it. Oh, here. whoa, I almost didn't make it back. Because I realized I lost the song there. So let's see. I've got a few more here. So, okay. So this one was requested from my friend Lalo. And I got to explain why I'm not going to play this particular song this time. He wanted to know that there's a song that's mentioned or supposed to be the B-side of a Beat of Life single way from way back when. And the song's called I Know What You Want. And he asked me if I could play on this one. In actuality, I was going to play it. I couldn't find it. Then I did find it. I listened to it. I almost lost my mind and decided that it's better suited for next week because next week is the Halloween thing. So I figure all the really dark stuff and all the really off-kilter A-Box stuff, like so the darker side, it's all going to be next week. So I think I'm going to save that one for next week, all right? So, but Lalo, you're going to get to hear it, and then you're going to say, I now know why you didn't want to play it. So, because this answers a question that nobody ever asks me. Everyone will always ask, what's your favorite song? What's your favorite album? Like, of everything you've done, what's your favorite? But no one ever asks, what's your least favorite? That song is my least favorite. I don't know what I was thinking. It should never have been out, but that's just my opinion. For all I know, people will like and go, oh my God. But that's just, you know, the way life goes. But I'm going to go back to the demo stages again. So one of the funniest requests I got, so let me see if I got it here. Let me look real quick. Man, I missed one. I'm going to have to go look in Facebook or something because I think I missed the request. But this one, now speaking of the most loved, most hated. So I'm going to play a song that people either love or they absolutely hate. So I always get these funny requests or emails regarding sets. And then people will say, hey, are you going to put this on the set? And I'm like, no, you know, or they're like, whatever you do, do not put this song on the set, please. And that's like funny to me too. So this song that I'm going to play, which has its own visuals here, is either loved or loathed. So to give you an example, on Twitter, someone wrote, I'm going to skip the title for now, blank has high energy, and especially the lyrics make me think someone is on the shit list. I love to play the song when the day does not go well, then all is better. So there you go. That's, you know, that's good, right? And then I have the polar opposite, which someone wrote, ah, shoot, I missed that too. Where is that quote? Oh, there it is. They wrote, I want to hear the story behind my least favorite Anything Box song of all time, which I think is funny. And they both want the same song, which shows you how polar opposite things can be, not just in the world, but in musical tastes. So before I play the song, I'm going to tell you about a little bit about its story. Well, one was that I had a friend come in that I wanted to do some record scratching on this song. Two, I was starting to do those drum sessions that I think I've told you all about, which is on Sundays I would get there and just play live drums all the time and record them. So one of those sessions wound up on an Anything Box song, and you know, it was definitely left of center. But that said, if you really listen to it, this is a synth pop song or a synth punk song. however you want to slice it. And the lyrics are punny. They're dark, but they're kind of funny. Anyway, that's just my own take on it. So I'm going to play that. I'll find the missing song if I can, and then I'll come back, and then I'll play you something else. And then, you know, you can keep asking me questions. Please ask, because I would rather answer your questions than me just come up with random bits. So ask away. Anything you want to know, today's the day. So down there, just, you know, ask your question. Or over there, wherever the thing is. Here we go. Let's play. Oops.
Told you the words meant anything, would this settle down? Just compute your calculations and never have a doubt. Cause if you're down on life again, you should recognize faceless attitudes alive. And if you won't just let it go, shake it off your shoes.
So yeah, that was Vile. Yes. And someone said, kick drum, pan left. Yeah, I know. Everything was nuts. Everything that you could possibly do to make a nutty song, that was a nutty song. But yeah, that was for JP Knights. And that actually generated some questions. So I'm going to answer them. Let's see. Where is that question? Someone said, this is going to be funny to answer. So on Twitter, Kathy asked the following question. So she's got four. So I'm going to answer all four at once because they're good questions, I think. So did you ever have formal voice lessons? I think the answer should be obvious, no, because I still think I have a very rough voice. But I did start singing early, and now I got to start to relearn, so it's always an experience. Danya took some voice lessons in and around the Worth era, and I think she did it because she wanted to strengthen her voice for stamina, and she taught me all these weird vocal exercises, and I learned them all. So if I got any lessons at all, I got them from Danya. So she taught me some exercises, and I use them to this day. Two, what performers, songs, or things inspired you to become a musician? No one ever believes that story, but it actually has nothing to do with rock and roll or hearing something on the radio. It actually has to do with being on the radio. My mom, for whatever reason, called the radio station when I was like 4 years old and said I could sing a particular song that was on the air at the time. It was a Spanish song. And they wanted to hear me, so she put me on the phone. I sang it, however a four-year-old sings a song. And they had her bring me to the studio. And when I was inside that studio and I saw their machines and their microphone, it's just like, my eyes are like this. So I think that was the first exposure I had to it. But I actually had no interest in music until after the drowning accident, which then somehow created some weird damaged part of my brain that decided music was the thing. And then, of course, comes all the heroes. Beatles, Kinks, Pink Floyd, Sex Pistols, you know, all that stuff. And then later on, Kraftwerk, Joy Division. So those are my favorites. You know, I've got many favorites, obviously. I can make lists of my favorite bands. Which brings in number three. If you could meet anyone, dead or alive, who would it be? Okay, so this one is kind of easy for me. So one, I would love to meet John Lennon, but I kind of did because I dreamed that I met him. So I have that one in my bucket list, and it was, as far as I'm concerned, I did it. Kurt Cobain, again, I had a dream, and I actually wrote a song with him in that dream, so I could honestly say, done. I think that's cool, and they're both dead. I would love to meet Paul McCartney one day because I think that would be cool. Tom York, I think that would be awesome. And I would have liked to have met Einstein because I think I would have some very interesting conversations about existence and time displacement with the good Mr. Einstein. But who knows? Maybe I can still visit him. It all depends if I get this thing running. But those are the people I would probably meet. And then the most dreaded question, who's your favorite singer or other band? You know, I can't really say, because if I do, it's like, damned if you do, damned if you don't. But I can tell you this. If, and this is a very funny if, but if someone said, you've got to do a quick grab for some albums before the entire world blows up and you're going to be stuck on a little island with these albums, like what would be there? What would have to be there? And I guess my answer is going to be kind of obvious, but maybe not. If I had to take one single artist with me on a deserted island, it would be the Beatles, because I have so many different eras that I would be able to pick from that I would just love to sing to, because I would need that. So I think they would be my favorite to take on a desert island. And I probably would take a couple of New Wave records with me too. But, you know, like I said, I have such a varied list that, God, who knows? So this next song is the one that basically opened the show. And I did it kind of, I don't know how I did it, but I did it. Don't know if it was good, but I did it. But that one was requested by a man on Facebook by the name of Oscar. And he wrote, I would love to dedicate Blue Little Rose to my daughter, Angelica. Through life and breakups, it is a reminder that her daddy will always be here with unconditional love. I will always encourage her and have her in my arms. And my arms are always a place for her to feel loved in. So what's your backstory for this amazing song? And the pic is of her and I while singing Blue Little Rose. And it looks like, from the picture that I could see on there, I don't know, I can't really show you the picture, but what it looks like is that they're at Sunland, which was probably the last one of the last shows I did last year. So that's kind of cool. So that was touching. So I'm going to definitely play that for them right now. And I'll put the tape back on and then, you know, whatever it is I'm saying. You know what I mean. So let's see. And we'll put the overhead. You can watch me read. And here's the song. Little Rose from the Hope album, and that was for Oscar and his daughter. I'm kind of liking this. It was easier to pick all the songs because all I had to do was just fulfill requests. So let's see. Who asked? So Jenny asked, have you been to other bands' concerts and which one is your favorite? Well, see, that too is it's a weird loaded question for me because obviously it all depends. To give you an idea, of course I have friends who are all in bands. So I love to see all of them in concert. So if I say my favorite was this, I will make half of them angry or sad. So I can't really answer in that vein. But I can tell you that there are certain performers that I think are really fantastic. I loved early days when I used to go see Depeche Mode. I got to see them do the Black Celebration tour. I thought that was fantastic. I loved them then. I really enjoy OMD a lot. I saw them play when I was younger. And I've seen them play more recently, and I thought they were really good. And they're still good showmen, so I find that really good. But again, so many, because I like to go see other bands play. But it's a funny thing. I mean, I don't know. I don't know if some of the bands that are listening, because I know that I have friends that are in bands that are listening right now and watching. So Hidden Souls, Farmacia, you guys can chime in. Me personally, it's funny. I have to sometimes turn off anything box when I go watch another band play, because otherwise I'm looking at the lights. I'm like, what microphone is that? Oh, I like that light rig that they're using. Oh my God, I like how they have that setup. That's a good idea. And so I start to make it becomes work. I start to extrapolate ideas of, oh, I would never have done it that way. I would not have done it this way. Or, oh, I think I can improve upon that one. It's a competitive thing in a weird way. So I think that I have to turn that off when I go to concerts. When I'm able to do it successfully is when I think I've seen a really amazing band, because it turns off that side of me completely. And I'm just in the audience, I'm enjoying it in the audience, and to me, that's magic. So, you know, I've seen that a couple times and loved it. And other times, not so much. To give you a really good example, New Order is one of my favorite bands. I love New Order, but I saw them once in New York City, and to this day, my review of that concert stays, which is, if I went to someone's house and they had a house party and New Order was playing in the backyard, they were brilliant. But since it was like Madison Square Garden and I saw it, it seemed lackluster because it seemed too much like a garage band with almost no lights, and it was kind of a boring show. But I still love New Order, so... You know, and then I saw them at the Hollywood Bowl and they blew me out of the water. Like, I was like, wow, how much they've changed. So it all depends. But I love going to see bands play. It's, you know, I'm a fan of music too, so I love it. But let's see what else you got. No! Uh-oh. I think my computer just went into sleep. Oh. So... Eric keeps piping in. He wants to meet Dave Gahan. He's going to try to meet Robert Smith. So, yeah, go for it. Go for it. Yeah, Nine Inch Nails were a fantastic band. I wish I would have caught them when they played the Pipeline, and I didn't get to see that because I had already moved out of Jersey. So I missed that. But that would have been awesome. I recently found out, speaking of the Pipeline, Mikey, since Mikey's watching, so I recently found out that the Flaming Lips had played the pipeline, and I had no idea because I love the Flaming Lips. Now, obviously, they played back in 92 or something like that. So I would have been just when I moved out again. When I moved out, it must have happened. But that would have been interesting to see back then. I would love to see that. See, that's another band. I think I want to go see them in concert. I think they would be fantastic. So. And someone said, I would like to meet you in person. I'm right here. I'm right here. You don't have to look far. I'm right here. Look. I'm just being funny. But, and people ask me, do we like Psyche and all those other? Yeah, of course. All those bands I love. I love everything that has to do with that genre. Spanning, gosh, man, I've been listening to music for a long time. So, yeah, I love all that stuff. So, okay, request. So, someone, it's going to be another one that's an oldie. So someone else who had requested Blue Little Rose wanted to know about where it came from. And to be honest, sometimes I'll watch a movie and the movie will leave deep impressions. In this case, it was I had just finished reading a book. And by some miracle, the movie version of the book came on. And when I watched it, it kind of left me in a really weird state. And made me feel really sad. So I thought that I would write a song about that. But it has nothing to do with the book. It's just the feeling and the impression that I got from that book. So the book is The Secret Garden. So if you want to know, that's where that song kind of came from. I pictured the maze that they run through. And I pictured someone being lost in that maze and someone trying to find them to tell them that everything's going to be okay, like that kind of feeling. But again, that's just some weird interpretation of something that may not have anything to do with the real thing anymore, because now it's your song. Whatever interpretation it has for you, it's for you. But it was supposed to be a song about hope and uplift, I guess. So on Twitter, one of the questions that was submitted, but not without a song, but underneath one of the requests said, I respect your drive and creativity so much. Thank you, by the way, Alec. How do you stay motivated? Do you burn out and hit dry spells? Absolutely. I hit dry spells probably just as much as I hit creative points. They go hand in hand. One day you love everything you're doing. The next day you want to tear up everything you're doing. In certain cases, that could be really dangerous for me because being on a computer, all I have to do is hit delete and that song is gone. But the same could be said about paintings, right? You could, I don't know, destroy it and decide you hate it. I try not to do that these days, but I do hit dry spells. Of course I have burnout. I'm human. I would not be human if I didn't. But what I did learn is that burnout will not cure itself. So you can't just walk away and think that magically 2 days later it's going to come back. So this is how I beat burnout. So for whoever needs to get this advice, I'm giving you some advice here. If you feel burned out with creativity, work, whatever it is, you have to find something in that work or in that creativity that is a little bit of a challenge. So it might be that, okay, so the song's coming out crappy. I don't like it. Fine. then let me open the manual tomorrow, and instead of, you know, getting away from actual songwriting, I'll get into song learning. Like, what can I learn about songwriting? What can I learn about recording? What can I learn about my craft? As I do these little exercises with myself, I find that the gateways open up a little bit, and you can go back to the song that you were working on and usually like get some perspective. So, you know, I hope that helps. But this next one, someone had requested, and I believe this was last week, and I just happened to see it. It was because we had played Diary stuff, and they wanted to hear a particular Diary song. And so I'm going to play this song, but I'm not going to play the Diary version. I'm playing the Anything Box version. Because, yes, there are versions that were, you know, flip-flopping. So this is called Because, and this is the A Box version. And I'll turn on the overhead, and I'll keep looking for stuff. Because there's something that someone asked, and let's see if I can find it. So I guess we lost the internet there for a minute. Which is sucky because it actually messed up a good song. Oh, well. I think we're all back, but I'm not sure. Are we back? I'm going to assume we're back because I see a green light. So, sorry. It's not my fault. Something keeps going on with the I think it has to do with the military base, because there's a military base that's not far from here. It's in Los Alamitos, and we've been having a lot of weird flybys. And every time those very specific planes fly over, it actually takes out our internet, which is really bizarre. So. Wow. Emilio, hi. Are you talking about the song I just played? That's crazy. But it's good to have you in the house. In fact, since Emilio's watching right now, I want to show you something. So I found this. And yeah, representing right there, man. I'm representing the pipeline tonight. But that's a sneak because next week I'm going to feature the pipeline a little bit more on the Halloween show. So, for sure. For sure that's going to happen. So, anyway, someone just asked me if I ever have I ever done a self-portrait? And the answer is yes. I couldn't find the particular one because I've done it more than once. The most famous one, because there's a famous one, because it was going to be used for like a cover of something, and we wound up not doing it. But the most famous self-portrait would have to be this one. So that one is from the Living in Oblivion video. And I had done like a bunch of them where I took stills from the video and I would print them out on photocopy paper and then I'd draw all over them and do all kinds of stuff. So technically that is a self-portrait, but I have official self-portraits I've done. And it's funny that you should ask that question because I'm doing a small, I'm going to be doing a photo shoot in the next coming week and to get some new pics. And then because I'm updating the site and there's a bunch of stuff I'm doing with it. So it has a lot to do with self-portrait. So stay tuned, I guess. You'll figure that out. So. So I'm just watching you guys. So this next song was requested. Let's see. I like when I get requests for weird ones, okay? Because then it's not always the same bunch. And this is one that actually no one's ever asked for, so I kind of it has a good place in my heart. So this is from Ken, and this one came from Twitter, but I think he also posted this on Facebook. So he wanted two different ones, but there was one in particular he wanted to hear. He said it reminded him of a that this particular song reminded him of a former lost love. And someone had actually written to me and said to play that song also because it reminded them of a lost love. And so it's like, I guess this one's always about the one that got away, which is funny because it's not really about that. I had this weird dream when I was like, I don't know, I want to say I was 14, 15, but I wrote it down. And in this dream, I met a girl that was crying on the river on a riverbank. And basically in the dream, I go up to the girl, put my hand on her shoulder, we sit down, we start talking, and for whatever reason, you know, we fall in love. But there was something about the euphoric feeling in the dream that stayed with me. And years later when I was thinking about stuff, and goes back to that question earlier about hitting a dry spell. One thing that I can always count on is to go back to my old books and my old journals. And in them, I'll find entries or bits and pieces of lyrics. And sometimes that'll trigger an emotional memory. And once you have an emotional memory, you have a song. Because songs are emotional memories. They're not just visual memories. They're not, it's not an a simply auditory thing. It's all encompassing. You'll have words. You have, you know, the feeling that you got from playing the music. And obviously the emotion. So this is an old one. It comes from The Universe is Expanding. And I actually put a video together for this one a long time ago. And it's not really a music video, but it is a video. So I'm going to play that, which I think is here. And I will come back.
I heard you weeping in my corridor. I asked your name, you would not say. I told you something to forget your tears. We spoke for hours and then we slept.
relics. I don't remember there being another version, Steve. Steve says there's a version where I screamed something. And I think there might have been a take, but I think it wound up being just erased. I don't think that we kept it. At least I don't think so. But yeah, that's relics. Which actually has a lot to do with the same feelings in this particular song that I'm going to play next, because I messed up the two people that had requested these. So I messed it up. Sorry, guys. Sorry to Mean Gene. Sorry to JP. And I think it was a guy named Matt who also had requested this next song, and I mixed up the story there. So similar theme. The theme was, well, it's a funny thing, okay? I've met, I guess what you would call it is transitory relationships, where you meet someone and it's never going to be what you think. So there's always the ones that got away. There's the, you know, that feeling. And I think I've been the one that got away. Sadly to say, probably on someone's mind. That's a weird thing to say, but it's true. It's, you know, it's funny. I think it's the Stills. It's either the Stills or forget the band now, but there's a lyric in a song that I really love. And it rings true. So I'm going to give you the sentence, which is, with all our technological know-how, we still haven't figured out how to deal with human loss. And it's true. No matter how technologically advanced we get, we're still ill-equipped to deal with loss, you know, because you lose someone, whether they die or, you know, whether, you know, you fell in love and it falls apart, whatever the reason is. That loss has to be processed, and each person has to do it in their own time, in their own way. And it's never easy, man. Never. So I can relate to that. So this next song was requested by Mean Gene, and this was the correct song. And this is from the Worth album. So we're jumping around from Worth to Hope, and, you know, it's funny. And yes, Peace is next. I know there's some Peace songs you're going to hear. And yes, I have a few of those too. But for some reason, in the requests, I have to say the Worth songs won out. It's interesting. But that's what happened. So here it is. This is called, you'll know if you don't know, We'll Put the Moon Overhead.
I thought the world would end, and I thought
Oh, I cut that off by accident. I didn't mean to do that. That's weird. It usually doesn't do that. So that was Come Away. That was for Mean Gene. Sorry, man, that I messed up your request there. So another one that I got a lot of requests for all the time, obviously, is Kiss of Love. But the funny thing is, I'm going to play it, but no one asked any questions. It's just like, just play it, man, just play it. So it's funny. So it's popularity, obviously. I do know. So I'm going to just play it. But I'm not going to play the version that is on the album. And I'm not going to play the version that you know as the demo. I'm going to play instead an extended edit that we did for an Argentine release. So most people in the U.S. never heard this version. When I come back, I will start talking about vinyl. We'll talk about Bitcoin. I'm sure that's a subject that's like, what? What? What did he just say? Because you're not like seeing that on the news all the time, right? So anyway, we're going to talk about vinyl and we're going to talk about Bitcoin, the two things. I don't know why I want to talk about the two things, but I do. So I'm going to play the Kiss of Love remix. And after that, we will keep going. So while I have you guys in the chat and I play the song and you guys are dancing and doing your thing, I want you to answer this question in the chat. Do you own any Bitcoin? Have you ever thought about buying Bitcoin? And, you know, I guess I'll start with just those two. Do you own any Bitcoin or have you ever thought about owning Bitcoin? And if you want, your thoughts on Bitcoin, because that's interesting too. And then when we come back, I'll tell you why that is the question I've asked in this particular weird episode 29. Anyway, overhead's coming on right now. Ooh, overhead. I almost want to do the overhead in black and white. Almost. Okay, but we won't. And here you go, Kiss of Love. We'll be right back. I don't like to single people out if they have had a bad experience. So I'm only going to say my condolences to someone that lost a child, because no parent should ever have to lose a child. That is truly messed up. So if anything that I do puts one iota of a smile in your heart, then I'm good. That means the world to me. So I'm so sorry, man. Oh, man, I can't even imagine that kind of stuff. Every time I try to imagine that kind of stuff, it puts me into a tailspin, and I could go down, just thinking about it. So I can totally relate to that statement you made there. So I'm seeing a lot of interesting answers here about my little question. I'm going to tell you why I asked that question. It's not so much that I think of Bitcoin as a, quote, investment. It's not that I, first of all, it is, in my opinion, a very good investment, even though I'm not an investment person and, you know, I'm not a stocks person either. But in 2009, I was introduced to Bitcoin, and I should have done it because at the time that I was told about Bitcoins, I think they were about a quarter. And yesterday they hit as high as 13.9. And just the day before that, it hit at 14. And I got a feeling it's going to stay at 14 by the end of this week. Why is that a big deal? Because if I had bought $20 worth back then, I would be super rich right now. And I wouldn't have to be worried about a single thing. I wouldn't have to be worried about gigs. Now, some people say, you know, the decentralized aspects of all these altcoins and Bitcoin and, you know, Ethereum, Stellar Lumens, all that stuff. And I saw that somebody said they own Stellar Lumens. Good for you. That's a good investment. I like what they're doing, too. Some of these coins, they're going to replace, and I'm not kidding, I'm trying to tell you this now, as a, not as an investor, but I think you really should read up on it. Because the monetary system's about to change, and I have a feeling it's going to be sooner than later. And I would definitely not keep all my eggs in one basket, if you know what I mean. So I would definitely look into Bitcoin. I would definitely look into Ethereum. If you are thinking about getting into cryptocurrency, I would definitely recommend at least those two to start with. But a question that ever since I brought it up, because my friend Robert asked me this, Mikey asked me this a few days ago, Steve asked me this a few days ago, when we were, I say a few days, I think it was last week when we talked, but when people ask me about it, they always say, oh, I can't afford a Bitcoin. It's $13,000 or it's $10,000. And people don't know that you can buy a piece of it. Just like a piece of a dollar, you can buy a piece of Bitcoin. So that's one thing. And the other is that some of the other cryptocurrencies are not that expensive. So one thing that I recommend you do is just to, if you just want to mess around with it, and I'm not getting paid for this or anything. This is not a commercial. I'm doing it because I really believe that there could be something really serious around the corner, and it's good not to have everything in one basket. So that is a repeat of what I just said. It's good not to have all your eggs in one basket. So really simple. If you want to buy Bitcoin, don't do it through PayPal, even though that was a big story the other day. I don't know if you read it or heard about it, but PayPal is now going to be able to, you're going to be able to buy Bitcoin on PayPal and store it there. But my recommendation to you is do not do it through PayPal. If you're going to buy Bitcoin, if you're going to buy Ethereum, if you're going to buy Stellar Lumens, Tezos, you know, all that stuff, go to Coinbase. It's an exchange. You can get an account on Coinbase. You can get an exchange on Kraken, or there's another one called Gemini Exchange. All really good places. And you can get started, and at least by looking at what's out there. Because someone just wrote, I want something that's federally insured. I don't think you understand. Federally insured only works if there's something to insure. And it's funny because I never would have thought of this stuff. Like if you asked me this stuff 5 years ago, I wouldn't have known diddly about economics. I knew nothing. I'm still learning. But here's one of the things I did learn. The dollar right now, a U.S. dollar, is being devalued. It's, you know, the Fed has just given, you know, it's at 1%. By next year, it could be negative 7%. That means if you have a 401k and you have an IRA, you just lost 10% of your investment. So I would definitely think about putting your money in other things. Vary it up. Because it is a very scary time financially. And I'm just going to say this because I'm not kidding here. I do believe in Bitcoin. And I do believe in the philosophy behind Bitcoin and most cryptocurrencies. So I'm all up in it. In fact, you're going to find out how much I'm all up in it really soon, because it's definitely in my future. So I made that mistake when I was younger with Bitcoin, but I'm not making it again. And I made the same mistake with Ethereum, by the way. I'm not going to make that same mistake again. To give you an idea, 2017, when I first heard of Ethereum and all the wonderful things that it can do for musicians, for artists, for all kinds of people all over the world, smart contracts. These are things that are unbelievable to me. If you read up on this, you'll understand why, because if you follow me at all, you know that I loathe major labels. I can't stand publishers. I don't like any of that stuff where the artist's rights are taken away from them. I really despise any situation or institution that does that sort of thing. That do what I call Hollywood accounting. You know, it the staple that they're going to charge you for on the contract is $100. You know, that's what they're charging you for the staples that they used. And that's why you're not getting paid your royalty this month. That kind of stuff. Cryptocurrencies and smart contracts ends that shit. It can't happen. The way those things work, blockchain, the contracts on the blockchain, they're immutable. It means that no one can alter these contracts. That contract that I signed between you and me for, let's say, a record or a piece of art, it's there forever. And everyone in the world knows what you paid for it, what the value is, and what the royalty for it is going to be. And these things, it's not so much they're coming, they've been here. It's just that now you're going to start to see it more in the news. So if you haven't seen the news about Bitcoin a few days ago with regards to PayPal, that was big news. And it made Bitcoin literally shoot up another $2,000. So don't take it sitting down. It's a wonderful time. It's as if you discovered, you know, the new world, and you can put some money into it. I don't mean put your whole life savings into it. But I'm definitely saying that you should do something, because I feel like there's something on the horizon and we have to be, you know, aware of it. And if you think I'm full of shit, that's fine. At least I gave you my 2 cents. It's one of those, like, don't say I didn't say anything, because I feel bad if I find something good and I don't share it. That's my nature. So I'm telling you, this is something good. Every research that I've done into this tells me this is the right thing. I'm all up in it. So, you know, it's time. It's time to make changes in this world on all levels. Even the money, even the way banks treat us is wrong. So, yay, Bitcoin. Anyway, we're like, what is he talking about? Anyway, if you agree, disagree, feel free. Talk about it because I want to get your opinions. And if you say you have links for me to read, that's cool. I will definitely. And if you're curious and you want to know where some of my sources come from and you want to learn more about it, like I said, you can go to Coinbase, get an account for free, and you can at least look and see what that market's doing. And not only that, you can read about each individual coin and what the philosophy behind the coin is. It's not just the coin. It's not like I'm collecting a piece of gold. I'm collecting something that could one day change the monetary scope of the world. And that, and it has that power. So it's pretty crazy. But anyway, I'm going to play a song. This one is from Worth. It is a demo. It was a request. I don't have the notes in front of me because my computer went black, so I can't even read the notes. But it was World Without Love that they wanted to hear. There was two requests. One was from Houston and one was from California. But I'm not playing the album version. I am playing the demo that I made that was going to be a pseudo remix back in 1988. So this is A-Box in 1988 doing World Without Love. Or in this case, it's called The World Without Dub. We'll be right back. Forgot about that stuff in the end. It's funny. Thank you for those comments, by the way. I love your comments. So I don't want to get into conspiracy stuff, although I love you, Ricky, but I'm not going to do that because that part, I don't have the answers. But I can tell you this, there is a race. There is a race to see who's going to be the one to do cryptocurrency first in the world. And there's a race, although I can tell you right now, we lost that race. I mean, I already know the country that won that race, but because I don't want to get into political debates. That's not my intention to bring up Bitcoin. The reason I bring up Bitcoin is in the cyber world, what gold is in the real world. You don't have to agree, but you can obviously see that it's happening. So let me give you a bit of perspective here. Simple math, if you would have put in back in 2012, I believe, it was at $500. So if you'd, you know, even bought one then, right now, that little $500 investment just made you $1,500. That's just one. So I know people who invested early, and those people are rich. So how long will that bubble last? That I don't know, and that I can't answer. But I can tell you this. Yes, I own some BTC. Yes, because I want to be clear. I have invested in Ethereum. I believe it's magic. All the things that it can do, I believe Ethereum is going to be a force to be reckoned with for life. I don't think it's going away. And if anything better comes along, oh my God, I can't even imagine it because Ethereum is that good in my mind, just on the smart contract side. So that side of it. Stellar Lumens, because I saw that someone owned some Stellar Lumens. Stellar Lumens I believe in is because I know firsthand when I used to send money overseas to South America, to family in South America, if you had to send $100 to someone in South America to help them out using the conventional methods, it used to cost almost $50 just to send $100. And then when they went to go get the money, they would have to pay a fee as well. So to send $100, to have that person wind up with $30 in their hand, it's kind of around that much. Whereas nowadays, if you think about not just Bitcoin, but cryptocurrency in general, and I'm going to use Stellar Lumens as an example. If I send someone $1,000 in Stellar Lumens, they're getting $1,000. And the fee that I might be charged is about 20 cents to send it to them. And a friend of mine, or, you know, and Wendy just said in the chat that she already saw a Bitcoin ATM. There are thousands of them now. There are thousands of Bitcoin ATMs. They're not going away. And as people get more hip to what Bitcoin can do and other cryptocurrencies can do, they're going to say, screw the bank. Why would I want to keep my money in a bank? It's my 2 cents. My 2 Satoshis for the day. I stole that line. But we're coming to that funky point. Yeah, we got to free yourself from the bank. Be your own bank. So it's funny. I saw a quote. Obama said this. He said he didn't really like Bitcoin because he felt that Bitcoin was like giving everyone a Swiss bank account. Everyone having a Swiss bank account. So I asked myself, what's wrong with that? But I'm telling you, it's not that. It's everyone with their own Swiss bank. Take that as you will. So you just never know. Anyway, so I'm going to play another early demo. This one's from the Peace album as well. Well, that one was from Worth. This one's from Peace. This is the first ever, because someone asked for this as a request, but as I told you, I'm not going to play all the normal versions, so excuse me. But this version's very rare. This is the very first recording of Just One Day. I think I played it in one, Quarantine Stream 1 or 2, but it hasn't been played often. But I'm going to play that, then I'm going to come back, we'll talk some more, and then we'll wrap this puppy up.
Thank you.
Just one day. It's funny listening to that stuff when you think to yourself, oh my God, I was a baby. I was a baby back then. I was a baby. So this next track, we're going second to last now because we're almost at the end. So this second to last track was a request from my friend Emilio, who is the pipeline for me forever. You're going to be forever connected to the pipeline. And I love that. As I am, which is funny because I am too, which is why I love it so much. So he requested Living in Oblivion, which is funny because I would not have expected Amelia to request that one, but he had a good story. He said, the year it came out, I was walking around in a town fair and a roller coaster was playing the song. So I don't know if he means that the roller coaster, like as you walked by the roller coaster was playing, but this took place in a town in Portugal called Arcos de Valdevez, population less than 10,000 at the time. That is amazing. And I find that so crazy when you think that we were in this room in Patterson rehearsing this song just a year before that and playing it at the pipeline. And, you know, sometimes I wish people had heard how we were before all that stuff happened, because then they would really understand Anything Box better. But I feel that if you ever listen to the original version, you get that sense of where Anything Box comes from. But so I'm going to play a version that sometimes makes me cringe because, and it's not the radio version, that you're never going to hear on this channel. You can beg me, I won't play that. This version that I'm going to play was actually unearthed. I think we played it Corn Stream 3 or 4. But this is a rehearsal. So if you listen close, you're going to hear Danya make a comment at the end. And I think both of us have colds, which is really funny. But I like this version because it's a full-on rehearsal. This is rehearsal of Living in Oblivion. So I'm going to play that, and then I'm going to come back, we'll wrap it all up, and then we say goodnight, folks. And I hope you've been enjoying yourselves. And look, I only bring up this other stuff because I feel it's important. Just like I feel it's important that you should vote. I'm not going to tell you who to vote for, because that's not my way. Because obviously that has different connotations for everyone. Everyone has their reason for voting for the candidate they believe in. So whoever it is you believe in, if you believe in them 100%, by all means, vote for that person if you really think that that's going to help the world. But that said, consider the following. Don't go by what people say they like or dislike about the person. Go research the candidate yourself. You should be making that decision without the use of social media, this guy, any website, any ad that you happen to see. It should come from your heart, what your heart tells you. Because believe it or not, your heart is pretty flippin' smart. So if you do the research on the person and you see where their issues are, you may find that neither of the two candidates that are currently being touted as the one is the one, and maybe you should vote for Kanye West. Just saying, whoever it is. I never thought I would see Kanye West on a fucking presidential ballot, but I did. Go figure. So, anyway, here's the rehearsal of Living in Oblivion back in the Patterson, our rehearsal room that we used to call the music room. Both of us having colds. And here you go, me old son. Mm-hmm. Another symbol ending. I love when she says that. So I've got one more, and then it's good night, folks, because it's that time. It's that time to say good night. So in black and white, I'm going to say good night. But before I do, I want to say thank you for being here. Thank you so much for spending these 2 hours with me. I totally love doing this with you guys. Next week, Halloween show, whatever that means. I think I'm going to pick the darkest or the slowest or weirdest side of anything box. I don't know if it's going to be necessarily the slowest, but it's going to be the dark side. I might even dress up because it's so messed up that we don't get a proper Halloween this year. So I'm going to try to make next Friday the Halloween of all Halloweens. So expect the unexpected. I hope you show up. And yeah, you can make some requests. I kind of like that. So if you want to throw some requests in, start doing it on the Anything Box pages, wherever they are. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, whatever you like. Make your request. You might get it. But think Halloween. And it's funny because you think there's not going to be any Halloween songs from A-Box, but you're wrong. We have a few. We have a few. So, once again, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for putting up with my antics. I'm in your way, whether you like it or not. So get involved, please. It'll make me feel good that I gave some advice like that. And some people like took it to heart. Now, I'm not guaranteeing you anything. I'm risking stuff too. But I'd rather risk it with them than the feds. That's all I'm going to say. I don't know how this turned into a Bitcoin podcast, but whatever. I'm in it. So I want you guys to, you know, at least look into it. Don't brush it aside. I did that and I could be rich. I could have been rich right now. I could have been a $100 million guy. I'm not even joking. 2009, it was a quarter. I could have done it. I had every chance or an opportunity to do it. And I didn't do it. But it's not too late. So, last song. Probably the most requested song on earth, besides Living in Oblivion and Kiss of Love. And it's the one we're going to end this whole thing off with. It is a demo. Again, this is a first recording. This is the first recording ever. I think I've only played it once on this thing, but this is the very first recording of the following song, and I don't think it needs a title. I think you'll figure it out, but after this song, we're done, so I'm going to say goodbye now, and I hope you tune in next week. You're going to see the flyers we made for the pipeline for Halloween. You're going to see some really trippy shit that you've never imagined that Anything Box would have done. So anyway, with that, let's play this song, Moon Overhead. Because the moon is overhead.
she left behind. She had the spirit to live her life so free. Although many people wanted to clip her wings, she ran away. She broke away the chains that they wrapped around.
I'm part of it. I'm, can't you see it?